Well, thank you so much, everyone, for coming to the San Diego Museum of Art tonight and our first Friday film series. My name is Alexander Jarman. I run the public programs here. Of course, First Friday Films, we always start off with a lecture, and it's really wonderful tonight that we have a living artist with us to tell us about his work. My job is just to go over a few of the rules real quick. If you have a cell phone, now is a fantastic time to go ahead and dig around in your pockets or the bottom of your purse or your coat that you brought in and find it, turn it to silent for us. We're going to have the lecture, we'll do some Q&A, we'll have a little bit of a break, then we'll do the film, and then Scott has graciously agreed to stick around after the film, and we'll do a little bit more Q&A then, so feel free to stick around for any of that. My buddy Matt is back at the bar, he'll be there all evening, so feel free to go grab some refreshment. And then lastly, if you are looking for the restrooms, you're going to exit out the door that you came in, you're going to go two doors down on your left-hand side. There's a huge graffiti mural, you can't miss it. You go up that hallway and the bathrooms are at the end there. The other thing I have to do is introduce our wonderful curator, Amy Galpin. She is the assistant curator for Art of the Americas. And the whole reason why we have Scott B. Davis with us tonight is because she curated a show of his work. So she's gonna come up here and get things rolling for us. And I would just appreciate you all putting your hands together and welcoming Amy Galpin.
Thank you so much for coming tonight. It's a true pleasure to have Scott here to talk about his work and to introduce the film Dead Man. About 2 years ago, I saw Scott's work for the first time, and I immediately wanted it to be a show at the San Diego Museum of Art. If you haven't seen Walk from the Sun yet, it's up for 2 more weeks. Scott, we're so lucky that Scott is based here in San Diego. He's had much success across our nation, showing in New York and Los Angeles. His work has been reviewed by the LA Times, The New Yorker, The Village Voice. His work is in the collection of the George Eastman House in New York, the Nelson Atkins Museum in Kansas City, the Getty, and many other illustrious collections, and most recently our own. So we are thrilled to be working with Scott. I won't talk too much because you're here to see Scott and the movie, but I did want to let you know that Scott has another show in San Diego opening very soon at JDC Fine Art in Little Italy. The show is Vestige, and it's an exhibition of recent work. It opens March 2nd, and it closes April 28th. And I believe we have postcards by the bar back there, so if you'd like to pick those up. So without any further ado, I just want to welcome Scott Davis. Thank you.
Thank you, Amy. And thank you all for coming out tonight. It's really a distinct honor to be up here and speaking about my work. It's an honor, too, because I once worked at this museum, and it was a formative stage in my career. Something that I thought about speaking about this evening was the fact that I built a camera beneath where we're sitting right now, and that camera really was transformative for me and my career. But really what I want to show you tonight is the work that was created with that and to kind of de-emphasize the tool, because the tool is really not the most important part, the work itself is. And what I've done tonight is I've structured the lecture to help you better understand the work that I do, why I do it, and how I came to start making very dark, minimalist, moody photographs. About 6 months ago, Amy and Alexander made an offer to me to give a lecture. And I, of course, said yes. I thought it was great. And they said there would be a film with it, and then I got to choose the film. And that was pretty intimidating, because I don't think of myself in relation to film, and suddenly I was going to build an evening where there was definitely a kind of direct relation. And after a little bit of thought, I landed on Jim Jarmusch's Dead Man, which is a film that I've really enjoyed for many, many years. And the more I started thinking about it, I realized that there were connections with this film in my own life. The film's essentially about a man, who's Johnny Depp, in the who stars in it, who travels from the East or the Midwest to the West and sort of finds a kind of almost disillusionment with what the West is today. His eyes were open to it. The film involves murder and some other things that I have nothing to do with in my own life. But it's really, you know, it's a great film about transformation, and it's a great film about perception. And perception is a really big and important part of what I do, of the work that I do. So I plan to talk about that as well and in my presentation. I decided to start this evening with a slideshow. And the slideshow, it's automated. And it's really, it's just photographs of how I travel, because I get that question a lot, like, what do you do out there? And, you know, are you scared? And all these other things. And I thought it would be a fun way to introduce it. I also work for the Museum of Photographic Arts. So I'm deeply entrenched in museums and and deeply entrenched in Balboa Park and San Diego, too. And as museum professionals, we often tend to take ourselves a little too seriously. And I wanted to kind of offer a counterpoint to that, to just start the evening on a slightly different note and show you some of the things that you don't see in the pictures. So this is about 4 minutes.
Records and we're making the dash.
Oh, I'm buzzing the club.
This is how we do it.
South Central dancing like nobody does.
This is how we do it.
To all my neighbors, you got much flavor.
This is how we do it.
I'll never come whack on an old school track.
This is how we do it.
I'm kind of buzzed, so because
this is how we do it.
South Central dancing.
Thanks. This is probably a little bit more of what you were expecting to see, are pictures like those that are on exhibit right now in the museum. And as I mentioned, I want to talk about the development of how I got here. So I'm going to move through this in three sections. I want to talk about three different ideas that really drive what I do. The first is landscape and my connection to place. Place means a lot to me. I've lived in San Diego for about 20 years, and I've really developed a deep connection with this place and with the landscape here. The other is process. I get asked a lot about the process that I do, and I want to talk a little bit about that just to contextualize how I make the prints that I do. I use a 19th century photographic printing process known as platinum prints, and it's not something that people run across every day, so I'm going to take an opportunity to talk about that. And the last is perception, really encouraging all of you to think about the difference between what you see and what you believe you're acknowledging or looking at and what you know versus what the reality might be, because they're often very different. And art, of course, is a lot about perception and a lot about interpretation. I decided to start with a quote. This is by a photographer named Emmett Gowan. And this is a quote that he wrote to me in a note, in a personal note, in 1994. And I was a young photographer then. I was 23 years old. And I had approached Emmett and asked him to give me some words of inspiration. And this is what he wrote to me, very simply, in the name of the unseen world, yours in kinship. And I had no idea at the time that that was really going to become a defining feature of my career. And so I want to talk about some of those influences that led me to begin photographing the unseen world. I mentioned landscape and my connection to place. I'm not ashamed at all to say that Ansel Adams was really my entree into photography. While I never met him, he was a hugely influential teacher to me. This is a photograph of Adams from the Eastern Sierra Nevada. And he was a teacher just through his writings, through the legacy that he left, through his activism as an environmentalist, and just a very aware citizen that his photographs went so beyond just the object. They were really about larger and more meaningful things. So early in my career, I mentioned my connection to San Diego. I really began to photograph the world here. I photographed San Diego County. I really saw it as a kind of box. And I wanted to find those places that people weren't paying attention to, that they weren't aware of, and sort of ascribe or show this overwhelming beauty that I saw here in San Diego that didn't have to be in Yosemite or these other kind of A-list destinations. And I photographed close to home, too. I've lived in and around Balboa Park for quite some time, and this is a photograph, both of these actually, are from about 1995. And they really represented for me just a desire to feel that kind of connection with place. But as I continued to become educated in photography and ultimately went and got trained formally, my world started to expand and I started to learn about other photographers who would have an equal, if not more, profound effect on me. And these included photographers such as Harry Callahan. Harry Callahan was a Chicago-based photographer who photographed his immediate surroundings. He photographed what was available to him every day, and he photographed every day. He made it part of his daily ritual, and oftentimes took photographs of his wife and daughter. This is his wife, Eleanor, who, interestingly enough, passed away on Wednesday of this week at the age of 95, and then his daughter, Barbara, who now has a daughter who's in college. They all visited MOPA a few years ago. It was a distinct honor to meet them, even without Harry. This is another one of Callahan's photographs, and I use this just to demonstrate the influence that it had on me, because Callahan would take what appeared to be a very ordinary and straightforward image, and he would really push it. He would push it to this level of abstraction that wasn't necessarily what he saw with his eyes or what you or I may have seen if we were walking there beside him with his camera. And that really intrigued me, that idea that you don't have to interpret a negative exactly as it should be, right, by the numbers or by the books. I ended up taking a workshop through the Museum of Photographic Arts in 1996 with the photographer Mark Klett, and this is one of Mark's images. And that was really probably one of the bigger and more transformative moments for me as far as teachers were concerned, because Mark's work really spoke to this intersection between man and nature, and he saw himself, or he sees himself still today, as a participant in the landscapes that he photographs. So he's not a distant observer. He's really somebody that engages with his photographs and doesn't shy away from things like power lines or snakes on the side of the road or cars, highways, etc. Those are all really part of a very viable landscape for his camera. As I dove even deeper into history and started studying photographers from earlier decades and centuries, I learned of the French photographer Francis Frith. And Frith's photographs, he made three trips to Egypt and made these photographs that were really stunningly beautiful and very austere. And he used these massive voids of space that to a modern eye really have this very contemporary sensibility, and it really appealed to me. So all this stuff is starting to gestate in my mind and really teaching me a lot more about photography than I saw at first glance when I looked at Ansel Adams' work. The last photographer that I wanted to share is a man named Robert Adams. And Robert Adams is a photographer who, in the early 70s, began to photograph the construction and the expansion of suburbs outside of Denver. And he really, rather than photographing with any kind of damning eye of this, he really saw it as just an observation of the world around him and saw everything as beauty. Robert Adams is a writer as well and writes very eloquently about these ideas of just simply loving the light, you know, regardless of what the content is in the landscape before his camera, to really just love the light and feel that connection. So all this stuff started to influence my photographs. So I showed you a couple of earlier pictures that were really focused on beauty, and I started to use the knowledge that I was gaining about San Diego County and started to insert myself into my own pictures. And looking at something like a camp here that I made under the largest pinyon pine in Anza Borrego, or this, a more subtle rendering, a photograph that I called The Road to Camp. And this was simply just my tire tracks. That's really the subject of this. And so you can see these kinds of ideas that I was working with of how small can I make the subject of a photograph and still have it be visually interesting and compelling. Or curious anomalies like this. This is actually a well-known location in Anza Borrego called Hollywood and Vine. And it's a remote sign that some flyboys put up in the Second World War out there, and it stayed out there, it's still out there today. And that really, you know, that kind of sense of history and the connection to that were really very captivating to me. And sometimes more recent histories too. This was a jack-o'-lantern that I found in one of the washes in Anza Borrego on Halloween Day. And you know, that to me again became a kind of viable photograph. It was a trace left by somebody. You know, from their time in the landscape. Or this one, which is an image that, it's an image of a saguaro cactus, and a saguaro cactus is something that, if you're not an expert botanist or even a remote botanist, saguaros are the denizens of the Sonoran Desert. They grow the large armed cacti that really have come to represent the Southwest. But this one was in a small town in the California desert, and it was really withered and kind of sad looking. And I found something very beautiful about that. And there was an irony in it that the town was also named for a desert plant. The town is called Ocotillo, California. And so I titled this Misguided Saguaro Near Ocotillo, California. I would be remiss if I didn't mention one other photographer that's had a pretty big effect on my career. And that was the photographer Edward Weston. This photograph is from 1937, when Weston received a Guggenheim Fellowship. He was the first photographer ever to receive a Guggenheim Fellowship, simply with a desire to go take epic pictures of the West. I wish Guggenheims were so easy to achieve today. But I wanted to talk about Edward Weston specifically because it relates to the film. When I was really starting to study photography, I came upon a letter that Edward Weston had written to Ansel Adams in 1937, and I'm going to read that to you. It's very short. And this is during his Guggenheim travels. He wrote, "I've made the last desert expedition of the year, or season. It's getting too warm. We went across the Colorado desert, taking the old stage route from near Julian to near Coyote Wells. A very exciting adventure, too long to be written. Got a beautiful negative of a fresh corpse, part of the tale." And when I read that, I was really intrigued by that. I didn't know much about Edward Weston, and I wondered, well, will I ever see this photograph? Like, here's this famous photographer that in 1937 went from Julian, our Julian in the backcountry, to Coyote Wells, which is kind of this anonymous, no-name town out in the desert. And it really captivated my thoughts. And I finally did come across, and I found that it's actually a very well-known photograph of his. And it's simply titled Dead Man, Colorado Desert. And this became this really interesting, almost obsession for me. I wanted to know who this person was, and so I started doing research and digging and digging and digging, and I found out that he was taken to a mortuary in La Mesa. He was photographed in what's today Anzabarego Desert State Park, and that he was finally laid to rest on my birthday, of course, before I was born, but it was really kind of eerie, and then I even thought I kind of look like him. It's sort of freaky. And he's buried in Point Loma, too. And the research that I did discovered that he had no next of kin and no family. He was a drifter, essentially. And I thought, gosh, nobody's ever probably been to his grave, and how sad is that? So as a kind of closure, I took a Weston book and I went and visited his grave. This is in Point Loma, in Fort Rosecrans, and kind of did an homage, you know, to him. And it really, what this did is it really kind of solidified my own sense of place here in San Diego. Because here I saw this sense of bigger history, you know, a bigger history of photography and photographers had taken place here a long time ago, and that I was starting to engage in that, not only as a photographer, but as somebody who was looking into, you know, the history of this one kind of random photograph. I mentioned process, too, and I want to talk about that pretty briefly. And then I make platinum prints. Platinum prints, in short, are a 19th century photographic process that requires a contact print, which means the size of the final print that you're going to make, so the prints that are in the exhibition here, are the size of the negative. There's no way to enlarge it. It's a very, very slow process. It was made really before the advent of electricity. And it requires hand coding. It's a very manual process, and was really... I was originally attracted to it because I saw this ad in this sort of techie, geeky photo magazine that said, "Old master quality is not for everyone." But what really got me about it is that it had a Rembrandt etching. And I remember always looking at that and I thought, why is there a Rembrandt etching in a photography magazine? And after a while, I had to answer the curiosity. And so I looked into it and it was actually very interesting to me for the process of being more involved in the creation of my photographs. I mentioned that I made a camera here at the San Diego Museum of Art, and many of the photographs that are on exhibit are from that camera that I made here, so it's a really kind of wonderful homecoming for me. But the reason why I made this ridiculously large camera was because I wanted to make bigger platinum prints. At the time, digital technology really wasn't there. It couldn't help you achieve that. And so I set about doing that. But I wanted to take a minute just to sort of talk about this process very, very quickly, to give you a little bit better of an understanding of what goes into the making of one photograph. It requires mixing together a few different solutions of this light-sensitive material and some highly highly valuable materials, namely platinum and palladium, and then hand-coding those onto a piece of paper, onto a piece of watercolor paper. It's essentially ordinary watercolor paper. This is a very fast process. It takes probably about 30 seconds to do what I'm about to show you. And then it requires spreading it around, of course, very quickly and very evenly. Spreading it, making sure it's smooth, until it's finally a nice kind of even coated piece of paper. So now I have this large, light-sensitive piece of paper. From there, I hang it up in a closet. And you'll notice that there's light. There's a lot of light. there's a lot of light coming in the window in that closet, and that I do this in regular daylight. It's a very slow process, both slow as far as the actual physical production of it, but the speed of the paper is really slow. I actually walk outside with these to get to my darkroom to process them. I'm that unconcerned about about exposing the paper improperly. From there, you subject this paper with a negative, you can see a negative there, in contact with the paper, to intense amounts of light. It's about the equivalent of 10 minutes of noonday, cloudless San Diego sunshine in June, or July, let's say, since the sun actually shines in July. And that essentially prints out an image, and from there you take it into a dark room. You can actually see the image here that's lightly printed out on there. And then you pour developer over it. So it's a wet chemical process. And the development of it, I also wanted to show a small sequence of these images, because the development of it is really something magical. You know, working in a darkroom is kind of a magical experience in and of itself, but platinum printing is almost even more magical, I think, because the development happens immediately. The sequence of images I'm going to show you here is probably about 1.5 seconds. So you can see I'm pouring this over, and this is one of my trademark, very dark black images. As it floods the print, you can see the print is immediately developing very quickly. And so you let it sit for a little while. Little while being a couple minutes. And then run it through typical clearing baths and remove all the remaining light-sensitive material so that you have a very stable print. And in the end, what you have is a print that's still considered one of the most permanent photographic processes ever invented, because what you're really dealing with in the end is metallic platinum, which is one of the most inert and stable substances on Earth, and cotton rag paper. So it really is a very handmade printmaking process, you know, hence going back to that ad that I saw, Old Master Quality is not for everyone. It really is like almost running a print through through an etching press or something. And then the last thing I wanted to talk about, and this really gets to the heart of the work that I do, is the idea of perception. This is not one of my photographs. It's one that I grabbed off the web. Does anybody recognize where this is? It's not Death Valley. It's in San Diego County. It's a place called Fonts Point. And it's in the Anzabrego Desert, and it's considered probably the Grand Canyon of San Diego County. It's really a very dramatic landscape. This is it shot at sunrise. And I grabbed this image off the web because I wanted to really demonstrate the most transformative period in my career, what really got me into night photographs. And I'm going to point out two things here. This mountain over here is a mountain called Borrego Mountain, and the one behind it over here is one called Fish Creek Mountain. It's not really important, but I went here one night in 1997, and I made this photograph. And when I did, I thought that I was setting up my camera over this beautiful precipice, and that I would make a photograph of one of the most gorgeous spots in San Diego County that might look a little different because it was at night. And when I processed this film, this was an 8x10 sheet of film, I held up that film, and it was so amazing because I could see through it. It was perfectly clear with this black line through the middle. I wanted to point out Borrego Mountain over here. These are all off-road vehicles, all this light. And then Fish Creek Mountain back here. And then these lights along the horizon are the lights of the Imperial Valley of Brawley, El Centro, and other cities out there. And then probably in the distance, Mexicali as well. And this, to me, really taught me so much, because it taught me that, number one, I wasn't paying attention. I wasn't really looking at what was in front of my camera, because this is what was in front of my camera. And I've since been back to Fonts Point at night, and it's so amazing to sit there and look at this just incredible, incredible vacuous space there, but to see that there's a city of 50,000 people out there and a bunch of off-roaders and other things going on. And it taught me that the world after dark is alive. And that was really what turned me into, I guess, what you call a night photographer. I'm still kind of uncomfortable with that term, but I guess it's what I am. I like to think I'm a minimalist urban photographer or something, but I still haven't found the right combination of words to adequately describe myself. But you know, as I started to explore this idea of night photography, it was like a whole new world opened to me. because it was a landscape that I was never paying attention to. I never thought about it. You know, I never thought that traveling at night, I could actually stop and pay attention to the fact that I was driving down a desolate road. This happened to be in New Mexico, as most of these pictures are. I should mention that. I was living there at the time, and that's really where night photography for me started to come alive, which is ironic because New Mexico is a land that's thought of for its beautiful light. It has incredible sunsets. I lived there for several years. But it was really the darkness of New Mexico that captivated me, because at night there, because it sits so high, most of New Mexico is about 4,000 or 5,000 feet, there's very little atmosphere. And darkness there is very different than any place I've ever been, in that it's almost a vacuum. And that vacuum is really what compelled me to explore this kind of vocabulary of this material, of platinum printing. And so I started going to places like this. This is Inscription Rock. It's a very similar vantage point to a 19th century photograph made by Timothy O'Sullivan. And I started to play on these ideas and think about place and representation of place and the ideas of perception. This is a photograph of Ghost Ranch, where George O'Keefe lived and worked for most of her life. And the combination of working in platinum and making these night photographs was really something that it hooked me. Because for once, I saw a quality of black that had texture and it had life to it. And it felt like how my eyes see. It felt like when I look at the world at night, a platinum print was really representing that. This is the city of Albuquerque. So it's a photograph of 500,000 people. This is a view from the Rio Grande Gorge Bridge, which is one of the tallest bridges in America. It was beneath a full moon. There's a shadow there of the bridge going across in the river, bisecting it. But it was this idea of these familiar and unfamiliar landscapes that I really couldn't get enough of. I mean, it was really like being born again to just see the world with these fresh eyes and to engage with it with meaning and intention. This is a photograph of lightning that was made outside of Tucson during their monsoon season at that time. But all of this really taught me to appreciate absence and taught me to appreciate negative space and the observation of nothing. I spend a lot of time in the middle of nowhere. It's where I go on weekends and when I have time to get away. And this kind of development of an aesthetic that didn't have any kind of foundation. I really, at the time, I wasn't aware of any other artists that were working this way and working with as little information as I could to still tell an effective story is what really drew me. In 2001, I moved back to California. I got a job back in San Diego. It wasn't really planned, but I was really pretty happy to come back. And so I took these ideas that I had developed in the desert in these vast empty spaces and began to photograph here, you know, looking at the ocean and other places. This is a photograph of Los Angeles taken from Malibu. So what you're looking at is the whole of the South Bay of Los Angeles and the Palos Verdes Peninsula there at the south end and a lot of planes leaving LAX and some stars too up in the sky. And this photograph really began to teach me that that there was a different vocabulary that I could continue to develop here in my new home, my repeat home, I guess, in looking at a place like Los Angeles. And that's really, I think, where my story starts to come to life. It's where the work on the walls of the museum today was born out of. And I really have one person to thank for that, and it's my dealer in Los Angeles, Michael Dawson. Michael saw the previous photograph of Los Angeles, and he said, you know, I love what you're doing, and I want to encourage you to keep exploring, to start looking at Los Angeles with the way you see the world. And so I did, but rather than staying on the outskirts of the city, I decided to dive into it, and I decided to start looking at the most ordinary, mundane, everyday spaces. I was thinking about Robert Adams, I was thinking about Mark Klett, I was thinking about so many different influences in this process and this medium that I had really developed ultimately as a practitioner of, And it became just a beautiful combination of things coming together, of using this language to look at spaces that weren't necessarily icons of Los Angeles, to look at the spaces that we all see every day, and to give them the dignity of a photograph. And in so doing, it started teaching me a lot about the city, and about the state, and just about my own understanding of perception and what I was seeing in terms of the world. I love working with as little as I can in terms of content, and finding things like this, which is over near LAX, looking toward Marina Del Rey, is something that really is a way for me to revisit a familiar vocabulary. But then also even looking at places like shopping malls, you know, that most people think of as propagating Southern California and defining it in a lot of ways. It's a land of consumption that we live in. And, to look at these places when the world's kind of shut down and people have turned their back on that for the day is really where things start to come alive for me. I learned long ago that sometimes the best pictures are behind you. And this is a great example of that. I was photographing something else on a kind of quiet portion of Sunset Boulevard, I thought the photograph I made was pretty successful. And then I was getting ready to put my camera away, and I turned around and looked behind me, and I saw this building. And I was just totally captivated by it. It was so amazing to see this empty hulk of what felt like this beautiful icon. You know, it felt like an Ed Ruscha. It felt like all these things. It was so anonymous and quiet and lonely and forlorn. And so naturally, I didn't pack up the camera. I actually did the opposite. I turned it around and took the picture. As soon as I was done, a couple of girls came by on their bikes. It was about midnight, and there was really nobody around. And these girls started yelling, going, "Oh, my God, whoa, whoa, whoa." And they spun into the parking lot where I was. And they said, "Wow, what the hell is that? That's got to be like some crazy 11x14 camera or something." And I told them what it was. And they said, "Who are you? And what are you doing here?" I said, "I'm an artist, and I'm just making work." And then they asked this question that just blew my mind. They said, "What are you photographing?" And I said, "That." And they looked and they said, "That?" And I said, "Yeah, that." And they looked at me and they said, "Why?" And I said, "Look at that. Like, how could you not want to take a picture of that?" I don't think they got it. And they said, "Where are you from?" And I said, "San Diego." And they said, "Oh, yeah, we've..." So they went on their way. Again, you know, for me to look at these spaces and just to find meaning in the spaces that we all inhabit every day, and to be cognizant of it and aware of it, and just give the time to look at it is something that's just, it's informed my life in many ways, and it's really informed a lot of my thinking and philosophies and other things. I don't only photograph in Los Angeles either, though it is a place that I'll admit I have a peculiar addiction to. And it's largely because LA is such an iconographic city. If I asked any of you right now to conjure an image of Los Angeles, you all could. And your brothers could, and your sisters could, and anybody, if I picked up the phone book and called somebody in Maine, they could do it too. Everybody has an image of LA. And I'm not really interested in that. It's a story that's been told again and again and again, and just doesn't interest me too terribly much. But these things do, you know, these weird, bizarre, decaying hulks in the San Fernando Valley or in the LA Basin or wherever they might be. I've really traversed a lot of parts of the city and certainly enjoyed it immensely. Recently, I decided that I can't keep ignoring San Diego, and I can't keep driving to make work. Though I enjoy it, and it's really great to unplug and disconnect and just get away from it all, from everything that we see every day, and see somebody else's every day. But I've really put it upon myself to photograph more in San Diego. And so I have. And these are a few images that I've made in and around San Diego. Most of them are in North Park. And it's really, it's encouraged me to even take things to the next level, to really look at my world, look at my everyday with fresh eyes, and to, you know, to take this thinking that I learned years ago at Font's Point of paying attention to what I was seeing, and to do it even more, right? What am I looking at every day that I'm not seeing? Like, where's the beauty all around me that I'm simply not aware of? This is the water tower in North Park, which was a daunting thing for a photographer to photograph. The history of photography is laced with images of water towers by a German couple named Bernd and Hilla Becker. And it's hard to, as a photographer, to see a water tower and not take a picture of it because of them, because we've seen so many and they're good, but they're totally austere and dry, and that was the point of the work. But here's this water tower in North Park, and this was about a month and a half ago that I made this image, and it was a foggy night, and I drove by it, and it was just so incredible. I couldn't not take a picture, and so I went home and grabbed the camera and came back and made it. And like I said, it's a little bit, it's a dangerous thing for a photographer to do, but I did it. I'm gonna encourage you all tonight when you leave to look at the world in a way that you never have before, to pay attention to it and see it as a landscape and see it as a creative palette. Maybe you'll find something that you haven't seen before, or maybe you'll go take a picture, who knows. And I'm gonna end on a quote. It's by quite a romantic poet, contemporary poet named Mary Oliver. And I thought it was really fitting. I came upon this quote about a month or so ago, and it really seemed to sum up a lot of my ideas and feelings quite nicely. And she writes, "Someone I loved once gave me a box full of darkness. It took me years to understand that this, too, was a gift." Thank you all for coming out. And I'm happy to answer questions, too. There's a hand. Yes. Sure. Yeah, the question is, how long are the exposures that I do? In an urban environment, they're maybe a minute, maybe 2 minutes. They're pretty short. I mean, it's enough time to get robbed, but I never have. In the desert, they can be an hour. I've exposed film all night. One of the things with night photography is it's very hard to overexpose, right? To improperly make an exposure. Though I think if you took any of my photographs to any technical photographer or photography training class or whatever, they would say they're technically totally wrong. They'd say they're all underexposed, because I actually shoot at night with like small apertures, like f16 or f22. That might not mean anything to any of you, but it's not what most night photographers do. And for me, it's really integral to conveying the message that I want to convey. Yes, question in the back. I'm a closet misanthrope. I'm not really a people photographer. And really for me to explore internal spaces, I study Buddhism and I think a lot about absence and you know, those kind of ideas that surround that, and what you learn by stripping yourself of information or facts placed in front of you. And that's really what's driven a lot of my work, is that kind of internal exploration. And so it's really not about putting people in it or posing them or what have you. And I actually find it's a lot greater a challenge for me to make socially relevant photographs about what people have left behind, about what people create or make. It's our legacy, right? I mean, much like Ansel Adams' photographs of the natural world, everything that I photograph is natural too. It's made by humans, and arguably we're still natural, I think. So I don't take a lot of pictures of people. In fact, I would be embarrassed to show you the ones that I have taken, except for the slideshow at the beginning, but that involved large stacks of Pacifico, if you didn't notice. Any other questions? Stephen?
I think you kind of answered it, but I was going to ask you, I think really what makes your work really unique and special is the dark aspect and the underexposed minimalist sort of mysterious look. And you sort of answered it just now, but I want to ask you, what really got you started with that visual style and then the impetus behind it? What is it?
Well, I've long been attracted to minimalist art from Agnes Martin and, you know, lots of other names of famous artists that I could list. But you know, that idea of really needing to spend time with a photograph or with a painting or with a sculpture to really allow itself to reveal itself and its meaning over time, or better, that it forces you to start to ask yourself questions, you know, and ultimately I guess it's a kind of self-education, if you will. But I was always attracted to that. And things like the photographs of Hiroshi Sugimoto, which are these beautiful seascapes, one body of work of his anyway, they're 50% water and 50% sky. I mean, you might say they're the most boring photographs you've ever seen, or you might think they're the most riveting photographs you've ever seen. But when I saw photographers who were working like that and who had mastered this way of speaking a language using so little information, it was just absolutely riveting to me. And so for me to make that very first photograph at Fonts Point, which was really important for me to share with you tonight, was a revelation to me, because it brought together so many of the different things that I was working toward. You know, the earlier photographs of putting myself in the landscape and photographing my camp and, you know, saguaros that were imported by somebody somewhere at some time into California. All those things were really, to me, exploring a kind of social landscape and exploring the relevance of that landscape. But to make that night exposure and to see that I just made a photograph that has absolutely no information in it, with the exception of just these tiny trace lines, and to realize that's an entire city of people and an entire, you know, culture of off-roaders who are out doing their thing in the desert, was just really profound for me. And so it really, it's what brought about this whole exploration that's 15 years old now or something. I realize I'm getting older. yes, John. That's a great question. Do I have to answer that in front of everybody? Where do I go from here? You know, I thought about showing you where I'm going from here, and I realized that's probably not the most relevant use of all your time, to say, hey, and then I've been experimenting with this new stuff. Well, I discovered this material. It's mind-bending. It's called color film. And then there's digital, and you can do the same thing with digital. I have been photographing in color, and I've really been using color not so much to replicate what I'm doing in black and white, but to start using it as a vehicle to allow me to explore ideas of time. Because I spend a lot of time in the same places again and again and again. I really enjoy that. I enjoy going back to remote places, to literally like one particular bush in the desert, and making camp there again, just to notice the changes that I see, or the changes that I might not see. And so I've been using color as a medium to explore that, to explore the nature of time in a landscape that's essentially timeless. And I'm not sure where that'll go. But if you stick around, I'll show you a print or two. Question in the back.
Oh, excellent photograph. And the idea of stopping your aperture is interesting. That's amazing. But along the same lines, part of the question. So where do you think you Photoshop? Today you can shoot with a digital SLR.
Yeah.
Just curious where you see it going now.
Now that they stopped making slide film as of today. Well, I mean, film to me, it's just a medium, and it's not something that I'm so wedded to that I can't embrace digital. In fact, I do use digital technology a lot. I shoot largely with an 8x10-inch view camera now, and I scan those negatives and output them digitally. in order to make a platinum print, right? So instead of making a print, I'm making a giant negative, and then I go make a platinum print. It's absurdly labor intensive, but you know, digital and Photoshop. I mean, those are they're interesting questions, I guess, in the sense that, sure, they pose a lot of new questions, right? What are the ethics? Like, you know, do you what happens if you take out a telephone pole or something? Is it cool anymore? Or is it right? Or is it wrong? Or are you being truthful? Or what? I think all photographs are lies. I mean, they really are, you know? No matter how much we might try to capture something that we think we see, an audience of people, photographs don't tell the truth. I mean, they tell an interpretation of the world, right? I mean, they really are about individual perception. You know, the short little audio video clip that I made in the beginning, you saw a lot of different people there that I travel with, and if I showed you the variety of photographs that we all make in the same place, you'd be astounded. It's people making paper negatives and lighting fires inside their cameras, to people like me who are making minimalist night photographs, to people who are making these collage works, to people that are doing color, and on and on and on. You know, the variance that's possible in photography, digital or otherwise, is pretty immense, and I think digital is just a powerful tool that opens 1,000 new doors. And I think you really only need about one or two of those doors, and that's probably the biggest danger in digital, is that there's so many options that can make it blend. Yes? Yes.
How long did it take you to find work? How much time do you spend thinking about why you're
Well, no, it's never finished. But you know, making art just comes from charged living, and from caring about what you're looking at. A lot of hard work and a lot of failure. You know, for me to condense 15 years into, I don't know, 30 minutes or whatever it is. You know, I'm leaving a lot of parts out, and I'm leaving out a lot of failures, a lot of experiments, a lot of struggles, and just a lot of development. I mean, these ideas, you know, you have aha moments, right? But aha moments are really, that's kind of a fallacy. I mean, really, the moments that just make you say, I think are the ones that are much more profound and pivotal. But those moments that go, just gestate for a week or a month or a year or 5 years. And so it took me a while to really realize that I was working with a language. And I'll tell you, it took me even longer to stop exploring all the other languages that I want to explore, because I have a voracious appetite and I keep wanting to try new things. And staying focused on what you believe in and what you think is relevant and important is probably one of the hardest tasks, and also one of the most meaningful. Yes?
So is there a methodology of
Well, no.
It's what it feels to
you,
right?
It is, yeah. And you know, you said lens selection, and I've had one lens for 15 years. I tried getting other lenses and stuff, and it just complicated things for me. And to have one lens and just to learn to see the world through that lens and to better understand that world, or as best I could, it's really liberating. And it's what freed me to just start taking notice of these completely anonymous spaces, you know? And it's a curious thing, because I've tried to be formulaic, you know? One year I said, I'm only gonna photograph on San Fernando Road. I will not photograph anywhere else but San Fernando Road, and I did. And you know, I mean, it taught me some things. It taught me a kind of discipline that I wasn't used to, and it worked, and I made some good pictures. But really, for me to just wander, driving is my guilty pleasure, and to combine that with a love of landscape and darkness and new territories and carrying my camera, you know, beside me or in the back of the truck, is really probably the best methodology I could explain. It's like that big? Is that what you mean? It's like 200 millimeters. I don't know what that means either. I'll take one more question in the back.
This is rather existential question, but
I love that.
Given where you came from and what you're trying to encourage, which I think is spectacular, perception, and your implication seems as if there is a truth by your reference to these are not the truths.
Sure.
So what the question is, what I have is, what ultimately have you learned about what the truth is, if there is indeed a truth, which you seem to have applied, given also in your study, in your Buddhist studies about, the absence of things being just as important as the presence.
Yeah.
Can you hear the question?
Yeah, so the question is, what is the truth? I would say the truth is in your heart, and I don't mean that to be simplistic or facetious or anything. But what I've come to of what I do is really just a very personal exploration of paying attention to things that people don't pay attention to, and spaces that they don't pay attention to, regardless if they're out in the desert and it's a sign for a bombing range or it's a building on Sunset Boulevard in Los Angeles. I find personal meaning with everything that I photograph, and I find that being true to yourself and listening to your inner voice is the best way to live a rich life, if that answers your question. Thank you.